continue to remember Brother Paul and Sister Betty, Sister Jewel and Derek. I know there's just a list of people we can continually go through. Remember Sister Joni, remember Peggy, and just remember all these requests. And I just saw a beautiful face walk in the door. So we want to say excited to see. Well, Sister Sue's face is beautiful too. You're beautiful too. But it's good to see Sister Nancy and Brother JC with us tonight. We've missed their faces, so we're happy to have them back with us tonight. It's things like that that capture your attention as they walk in the door, and it puts a smile on your face when you've not been able to be with people or see them. It's just so good to have them back. Anyone else? If not, all unspoken requests, if you'd let it be known tonight. If we could stand, we'll take these requests to the Lord in prayer tonight. Brother Greg, would you mind to lead us, sir, in prayer? If you have tithe and offering tonight, you can bring that up, but the ladies are going to lead us tonight. They're going to open up with a hymnal, so if you don't care to grab one of the hymn books in front of you, and we'll help and sing along with them tonight.
You know, I think this also comes at good time because if you start looking around, you can see the little shoots for the Easter lily starting to come up. And it's so exciting every year when you see those little green shoots because you know that spring is coming and new life is coming. What an awesome representation of our Lord and Savior, right? That he gives us that new life. 285.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow, he's my comfort. In trouble, he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempts me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna, he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Let's do verse 3 again.
He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here. While I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, do you worship Him tonight? Amen. Do you adore Him tonight? Do you believe that He is everything that He says that He is? Amen. Praise God. I truly believe that He is exactly everything that He says that He is, and I am thankful for that tonight. I'm thankful for His love. And I know I say that a lot, and I get up here every service, and I go over that seems to me that same routine. Amen. But I think it's important. Amen. I think that we really, truly have to understand, amen, of who He is, amen, and everything that He is, praise God, and truly to know, amen, that He is everything to me. Amen. He is everything to me. I'm so thankful that we ended service this morning the way that service ended, with our praise reports, our testimonies, amen, praise God, because it just fired me up, amen, for the rest of the evening. And so I'm truly thankful for that. And the Word tells us that we, amen, overcame Him, the enemy, praise God, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. And so that is very, very important, amen, and to know that and to understand that. Tonight, amen, we're going to talk just a little bit about His blood. We're going to talk a little bit about the veil. We're looking at our new Bible devotion that we've started out. And as some have already mentioned, you know, what day are we starting on? Where are we at? And as Sister Kim said before service, you know, they got here a little late. We tried to get them as quick as we could. But, amen, Nashville was shut down for about a week or so. And UPS was shut down. And FedEx was shut down. And every other carrier, amen, was shut down for a while. So it kind of delayed things getting here with all the ice and the storms that they had. So if you've got those and want to follow along, we're going to be starting. It's the second week is where it's picking up at on page 17. Actually, it's day 11 through day 16. Amen. It's where it is. Tomorrow's going to be starting day 17. And it actually started on Ash Wednesday, which I think was the third. I think it was the third Wednesday in February. So, but that's where we're going to start at tonight. So we're going to pick up in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 7. It's going to be our opening text tonight. And so if you would please stand with me for the reading of God's Word, and we'll simply read these scriptures tonight. We're going to talk about these. We're going to break these down just a little bit and dive into the Word a little bit. Amen. Praise God. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 7, it says this: there is a time to rend and a time to what? And a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak. Very important words, amen. Very, very powerful words of wisdom right here, amen. Let's go together to the Lord in prayer this evening, amen, as you pray for me, amen, as I pray for you tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank you for this time again, this opportunity. Thank you for the love that you have given us. Thank you for the worship. Thank you, God, for our praise warriors. Thank you, Father God, for everything, looking around and yes, and seeing, Father God, those new blooms getting ready to blossom to signify that there is a time of change, that there is a season that is coming to an end, in a season that is beginning to take place. And Lord, we're so thankful for that, Lord. And we're just so blessed to be called the children of God tonight, Lord. And Lord, help us never, ever to take it for granted. Help us to never, ever take our salvation, Lord God, for granted, and to take church for granted, and to take God's people for granted. But Lord, help us to look to you each and every day, the author and the finisher of our faith. Help us to draw nigh one to another, Father God, as we look to you, Lord God, above all things. God, and truly, Father, help us to lean and to desire, Lord God, as we talked about this morning, to desire with our heart's cry to be in your presence, to seek your face, Lord God, and to know your ways. Forgive us, I pray, the many times we fail you. Forgive us, Father, the many times that we do come short. And Lord, we're going to do our best tonight to give you praise, to give you honor, and to give you glory. For it is truly all of these things that we humbly ask and pray tonight in Jesus, His holy, sweet, and precious name. And the church says, amen and amen. We begin to read here in Psalms, or in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 7. And on this particular day, on day 11, it talks about a time to tear and a time to mend. And reading over this and looking at this, and then it had you to look at Psalms chapter 85. And if they've got Psalms, yes, thank you for Psalms 85. We're going to read verses 1 through 13. He says, Lord, thou hast been favorable unto thy land. Thou hast brought back the captivity of Jacob. This is a good thing. Thou hast forgiven the iniquity of the people. You've covered all their sin. Oh, this is sounding good, right? Thou hast taken away all thy wrath. Thou hast turned thyself from the fierceness of thine anger. Turn us, O God, of our salvation, and cause thine anger toward us to cease. Wilt thou be angry with us forever? Wilt thou draw out thine anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again, that the people may rejoice in you? Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us thy salvation. I will hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace unto his people and to his saints, but let them not turn again to folly. That's very important. Surely his salvation is nigh them that fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Mercy and truth are met. This is the key word that we want to get tonight in verse 10. Mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. Yea, the Lord shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. Righteousness shall go before him, and shall set us in the way of his steps. Praise God. This is important as we tie, as we look at Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 7, and then you bring in Psalms chapter 85, and he talks about how that God has come in and he has brought back the captivity of Jacob. He's brought the people back together. He has forgiven their sins. He's set them free yet once again, delivered them again. And then the psalmist continues to ask. He says, will you be angry with us forever? How long will your anger kindle against us? He shifts gears from there and about halfway through, and he says, I hear what you're going to speak. And that you're not going to, that the people don't need to turn back to where they came from. In verse 9, he says, surely that salvation is nigh that fear him. So it shifts gears and talks about the forgiveness of sins, talks about a covering, talks about all these things, and gets down at the end. And he says, now look, he says, salvation is near you. Salvation is nigh to them that fear him. Mercy and truth are met together. Tearing and mending are opposites. Amen. To tear and to mend is two different things. Tearing is pulling it apart, and mending is what? Putting things back together. But here we see, and this is good in this little study, it says tearing and mending are opposites. But as Jesus suffered and died, they formed one seamless act. There was the tearing, amen, of what? The tearing of his fleshly body, amen, the tearing of the veil. All of these things were torn, but also things were what? Mended back together. So if we see what was torn and what was mended back together, the relationship between God and the people through Jesus Christ. So there was a tearing on one side, but then at the same time there was a mending. So tearing and mending went hand in hand, and that's why Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 7 says there is a time to tear, and there is a time to rend and a time to sow. The time of tearing had come to an end. The time of separation, amen, so to speak, had come to an end for God's people through the death, burial, amen, or through the birth, the life, the death, and the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that he brought the tearing to an end, amen, and mended it back together on that great day. The psalmist writes that mercy and truth are met together, righteousness and peace have kissed each other in Psalms 85 and 10. At the cross, the love of the Father met the truth of our disobedience. It was there that the righteousness of Jesus satisfied the wrath of the Father. Peace and righteousness came together as one. And I don't know how anybody else feels about that, but that's beautiful words to me. It's beautiful, beautiful words to me, because I understand the wrath of God was being poured out. The wrath of God was being poured out upon Jesus Christ, amen, the righteousness of God. And because of that, and because he took that and placed it on the cross, amen, now that those things have come together, then the wrath of God is not coming out upon me, amen, but it came out upon him. And I am thankful for Jesus Christ, amen, that he endured the wrath of God. He endured the wrath of God for my sins. Amen. I don't know how it makes everybody else feel, but it makes me feel appreciative. It makes me feel blessed. As the veil in the temple was torn in two, God's plan for our salvation was coming together. In the tearing, God's relationship with his creatures was being mended. Amen. That the tearing was also bringing that mending. Praise God. Does anybody have any thoughts on day 11? On talking about that, on a time to rend and a time to sow. Any thoughts at all? I don't have to be the only one to stand here and talk. All right, if we look at the next day as we continue on with this week of this past Tuesday, amen. If you look at day 12, he talks about a new and living way. And looking at this scripture in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 12, and we did a beautiful study, and the Lord took us through the book of Hebrews over several weeks and the messages that he had given us several months ago. And this is, again, one of those dynamic moments. He says, but this man, after he, talking about Jesus, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, for how long? Forever, now has sat down on the right hand of God. And because you have to remember, amen, according to the Old Testament, that this offering, that this sacrifice was daily. They was bringing these sacrifices into the temple daily, and then once a year for the sin atonement, amen, that was happening once a year. If you look at John chapter 14 in verses 1 through 7, we're going to go there right here in just a minute, that we see something very interesting. So, and this is what the study wants us to look at. He says, try to imagine the sights and the sounds of these words. In Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 11, every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices. So it was day in and day out offering the same sacrifices over and over and over and over again. Amen. But then comes the prophecy that says, look, there's coming a day that there's going to be a man that's going to come forth. You're going to call his name Jesus, and he is going to be the one-time sacrifice for sins. It's going to be done. It's going to be completely over with. How many sacrifices a day? How much blood was spilled upon the ground? Walking into the temple was a walk past death. Don't forget that, because it was right there on the outer court, amen, or just on the inner court, so to speak, from coming outside and coming inside, amen. It was right there. It's where the brazen altar was set up. The sacrifices was taking place, and everything was happening right there. And to get closer to God, you had to get past the scene of the death and get into the actual inner court. And then from there, you went into the high priest did, rather, into the Holy of Holies. Then, when the veil was torn, the separation of the veil being torn, all this changed to become a new and living way. Because the veil on the inner court is what separated the Holy of Holies from the inner court. And remember that this veil was over 3 feet thick. Over 3 feet thick worth of material that had separated this. And then once a year that high priest could go in. But something that the Lord has brought to my attention in doing this and thinking about this is this particular point, that to get to him was a way past death, that you had to walk past death, amen, to get to him. What does that mean? That means I got to die. This is what that representation was. He's like, look, there is a new and a living way, and it results in a death. Yes, Jesus died, amen, so that we could live. He died and brought the separation was no more, and brought the two back together through the blood of Jesus Christ. But when I accept him as my Savior, amen, the Word says that the old man is going to die. The old man has to die, amen. And too many times that we get, life happens and things happens, and we're like a pack mule. We put our backpacks on and we begin to take on all of the things of the world, and sometimes our flesh, and things begin to creep back in. And amen, and we need to have that recognition and that symbolism, that when we come into God's presence, amen, that I have to remove those things and I have to die daily, as Paul said. I've got to die daily. I've got to take those. I've got to rid myself from those things. He even said it like this. He said, let us lay aside the weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Amen. Looking unto Jesus, which is the author and the finisher of our faith. So we've got to set those things aside. A new way, no longer marked by blood and death, a living way. He who died as our sacrifice is alive. Praise God. How many people are thankful that he's alive? Man, he is alive and well. Then we skip over to John chapter 14 in verses 1 through 7, and we read this. Let not your heart be troubled. Now, I thought about this in looking at this devotion that they were giving us here on this particular day. And I thought, you're going to talk about Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 12, and you're talking about the man Jesus offering the sacrifice, dying, amen, and is seated at the right hand of God. We're talking about Amen. These things that are taking place in the temple, and understanding that there is a new way that has been made, understanding that people were still hung up at this particular time on the old way. Then comes John, amen, chapter 14 and verse 1, with a stamp or a seal of approval, so to speak, saying, look, I've got the scriptures. And if you've got your Bibles and you look at them, and you've got some that's got the words of Christ written in red, you will find out that this particular chapter is written in red. So Jesus is speaking, and he says, let not your heart be troubled. If you believed in God, you believe in God, then guess what? You can also believe in me. Why can you believe in me as well? Because me and my Father are what? We are one. John chapter 17, you can read that. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, guess what? I'm not going to leave you. You're not going to be by yourself. I will come again. I will come again and do what? And receive you unto myself. Amen. Understand this. This is personal. Do you understand this? This is, what is the relationship between you and God? What is the relationship that you have today with God? Is it religion? Or is it relationship? If it's relationship and not religion, then it's what? Then it's personal. That's why it's called a personal relationship with Christ. That's what separates the masses. Okay, this is what brings the separation in. I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It is so personal. The relationship that I have with Jesus Christ is so personal that he's coming back for me. He's not coming back for Sister Kim. He's not coming back for Sister Melissa. Why? Because that's not my relationship. My relationship is between me and Jesus, and his word says that he's coming back again for me. But then Sister Kim says what? I too have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and he's coming back for who? He's coming back for her. And the same thing with Brother Greg and anybody else that has a personal relationship with Jesus. And you can sit and you say, look, I'm coming again for you. I'm going to receive you unto myself, that where I am, you're going to be as well. Amen? That's something to rejoice about. He goes in on into verse 4. I love it. He gets into verse 4 and he says, and whither I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, look no further. Jesus said, Brother Greg, look no further, because you're looking at me. If you'll just keep following me, if you'll keep your eyes on me, Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. Verse 7, if you had known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth you know him and have seen him. Why? Again, because I and he are one. This is important. This is good. The way through Jesus is the way of abundant life. Life filled with joy, hope, and peace. A life filled with joy, hope, and peace. Amen? I don't have to go to the temple anymore and bring my sacrifice to the priest and go through those motions, praise God, because Jesus made a better way. Amen? He made a better way, and I am thankful, praise God, that he made, as the title of Tuesday's lesson was, a new and living way. Amen? I am thankful for that. If we look at Wednesday's, which is day 13, we look at Hebrews chapter 10. We're standing in the book of Hebrews, and we're going to verse 20. And we're going to talk, we're picking up right where day 12 ended, talking about a new and living way, by a new and living way which he hath consecrated for us through what? Through the veil. Here we're bringing the veil back into the picture. Now the veil is not 3 feet thick, but he's referring to the veil as what? As his flesh. He says, that is to say, his flesh. Because his flesh had to be what? It had to be torn. The flesh of Jesus Christ had to be torn. Was it torn? Oh, yes, it was. Terribly. Terribly, terribly, terribly torn. 39 lashes that he took with a cat of nine tails. Bones exposed, bleeding profusely. And don't you know that, think about this. When that man hit Jesus, and the first drop of blood that came out, I want you to know tonight that that would have been enough to save the entire world. That very first drop of blood that hit the ground would have been more than enough to save the entire world, to wash away all the sins. How do you know that? Because his blood, it is his blood. Amen. There's not an amount. The Bible doesn't give us an amount, but it says it's the blood of Jesus, that without the blood of Jesus, there is no remission. So that first drop is enough for the remission of sins. Let that sink in. Is the blood of Jesus powerful? Oh, praise God, it's powerful. So we see here that he says that, look, it's a new and living way. It's consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. We're going to go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 through 21. We focused on the veil being torn in two. However, something far greater was torn. Today's Bible verse makes it clear that Jesus' flesh is the veil. Who can imagine the horror of crucifixion? It's the worst way to die in those days. The agony. It is not a pretty picture. Nonetheless, our hope and confidence rest in this promise. In the promise of what? In the promise of Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 20, a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. We'll go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18, 19, 20, and 21. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed, let this word speak to you tonight. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed, because we look at ourselves and we think that we're worthless. People have a mentality and can get a mentality that they are worthless, that they are good for nothing, that you're never going to amount to anything. All of these negative connotations that the world, and remember, I talked about it this morning, that your families can put on you. And when does it start? When you're about that big. I'm going to do my best not to get on a soapbox on that one, but because it infuriates me. Infuriates me to no end to hear somebody's parents say to their child, "You're no good. You're worthless. I don't like you. I don't love you. Nobody loves you. You're never going to amount to anything. I got a place behind the woodshed that I'd like to take some of them people." Amen? I mean, I'm just speaking truthfully, because they are precious. They are worthy. And they are loved. Amen? Praise God. And so I want us to not miss that. So this word speaks to us. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by tradition from your fathers. Verse 19. But, there's that but. I am so thankful for these in the Word. But with the precious blood of Christ. That's what you were redeemed with. That's how worthy you are tonight. Amen. That's how much God loves you and cares for each and every one of us in here. I don't care, amen, if you were just born, amen, or if you got one foot on a banana peel and another foot in the grave. God loves and cares for you, and you are worthy. You are not worthless, but you mean something to us and you mean something to Him. How do you know that? Because I have Scripture to prove it. Amen. I have Scripture to prove it. And what is that? He tells us, he says, you are not redeemed with corruptible things that are going to pass away. But praise God, you were redeemed with something so great that you can't even imagine the greatness of the blood of God, of the blood of Jesus Christ. and what it means. He says, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, verse 20, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Go back to verse 20. Let's read that again. Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world. He was here from the beginning. Thank you, Jesus. He was here from the beginning. But again, where is this personal relationship at? Because but was manifest. What does manifest mean? Huh? I can see him now. He was revealed. He's always been here. But it wasn't until this time, at this particular point in history, that he's going to be revealed to suffer and die in these last times. For who? For me. Not for Brother Greg. Not for Sister Melissa. Not for Sister Kim. Not for anybody else. But it's the personal relationship with me and Jesus. And he was manifested in these last days for me. You've lost your mind, preacher. No, that's how much I believe in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen? He died for me. That's the value that we as the church of the living God needs to put on your relationship with Jesus. Amen. Yes, that he died for the church. Yes, he died for the church. He died for the church to be in existence. And because he died, we can be the church. Amen. But it's individuals that he died for so that you could come together with one mind, one body, one spirit, and one accord, gather together to be the church. Amen. We are not the church. Do you understand what I'm saying? Amen. Praise God. We are the church because Sister Amanda came together, Sister Kathy came together, Brother Greg came together, and we are now the body of Christ. But it begins where? It begins with an individual and a personal relationship. So therefore, I take this scripture to me personally. And this is the value that we got to put on this. Verse 21. Who by him do believe in God that raised him up from the dead and gave him glory, that your faith and hope might be in who? Might be in God. It's not going to be in anybody else. But my faith and hope is going to be in him. We focused on the veil being torn into two. However, something far greater was torn. Today's Bible verse makes it clear that Jesus' flesh is the veil. Who can imagine the horror of the crucifixion, the agony? It is not a pretty picture. Nonetheless, our hope and confidence rest in this promise, and that is verse 19 of 1 Peter chapter 1. You have been redeemed with the precious blood of Christ. Can we rejoice in that? I mean, let's think about this for just a minute. And I'm going on. We're going to go on into Thursday, but I want us to think about this for just a minute. I think in preparation to come to church, in preparation to come into God's house, to worship, to pray, to read, to do these things, I think it's a good idea to remember. It's a good idea to remember who he is and what he done for you. That sets the stage for everything else. Does that make sense? Because if I truly, we could not have no worship music. We could not have the ladies or the men up here on the stage and playing on the piano and beating on the drums and up here singing and we don't need that to worship him. You don't need those things to worship him. I worship him, amen, because I love him, because of what he's done for me. Because I understand just how good he is. But we do these things to do what? To assist the people in worshiping. Does that make sense? I worship Him, amen, praise God, because He died for me. I praise Him because He set me free. Because He spilled His blood and died a painful, agonizing, terrible death for me. Amen? And that is why I praise Him. That is why I worship Him. Amen? Oh, He's so good. Thursday, let's look at Thursday. We're getting ready to close right here in a minute. Let's look at Revelation chapter 21 and verse 3. Now we're going somewhere. Because if we're going to rejoice, then we need to continue to rejoice. It's a sad day, amen, that Christ had to die, but because He did die, I can rejoice today. Amen? I can rejoice today. So if we're going to rejoice, then let's go ahead and rejoice. Amen? Revelation 21 and 3. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God. Today's, on day 14, on Thursday, it talks about paradise reopened. Paradise reopened. This is interesting. Skip to Matthew chapter 13, verses 13 through 17. This is good. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because this is why He speaks, that Jesus was speaking to them in parables, because they see, but they don't see. They hear, but they don't hear. What do they see and don't see, and what do they hear, but yet they don't hear? Huh? Of who He truly was and what He was really trying to get them to see and to understand. Because He was telling them of things that was getting ready to take place, and He was speaking to them in parables so that they could understand what He was saying. Because, again, Jesus, He had to make sure that the people understood. Is He the author of confusion? No. Does His Word tell us that? His Word tells us, He says, I'm not the author. He says, that's the enemy. He's the author of confusion. I'm not of chaos. I'm not of confusion. He said, this is the way that I am. And He said, so therefore speak out of them in parables, because they seeing see not, hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. Verse 14. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, By hearing you shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing you shall see and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their hearts and should be converted, and I should what? Heal them. Verse 16. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Now, let's take a transition for a moment. You've got the religious people. You got the religious people. The scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. You got these people that were there. This is who I believe that He was referring to. Because now He shifts gears in verse 16, and He's talking to the people that are there with Him. Now, there are some of the religious sect that are there as well. But He shifts His focus, and He says, But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Verse 17. For verily I say unto you that many prophets and righteous men have desired. This is why I think that He was referring to the scribes and the Pharisees and the Sadducees, because He says here, for there have been many prophets and righteous men that which have desired to see those things which you see and have not seen them. Why? Because their hearts were not right. Their hearts were dull. Their hearts, it was a set of motions that they were going through, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which you hear, and have not heard them. Now let's fast forward to us And let's think about this for just a minute. Have you seen and heard? Oh, I've seen Him. And I've heard Him. And because I have seen Him and I heard Him, what did it do to me? It changed my life. That's what it did. That's what it did. It changed my life. Embroidered on the tapestry of the veil was a panorama of the heavens. When the veil was torn, the message was clear. Paradise was reopened. This was foreshadowed 3 years earlier at Jesus' baptism when He came up out of Jordan's waters. The heavens were torn open and God spoke in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 17 and said, "This is My beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Then at the cross, as Jesus took His last breath, the veil was torn open and the centurion declared, "Truly, this was," what? "The Son of God." Let that sink in for just a minute. These two events are connected by one message. The life and sacrifice of Jesus pleases His Father. Paradise is open again for those who call Jesus their Lord, amen, and their brother. Think about that. Let that sink in, amen, that because of what He did has made a way for you and for me. I'm thankful for that tonight, amen. I am thankful, praise God, that heaven is opened, amen, and that it's taking members daily. Amen. How do I become a member of heaven? Oh, it's simple. The Spirit of the Lord will draw you. You realize that you are a sinner in need of a Savior, and then you simply say, "Jesus, save me. I need saving. I want You to live in my heart. I confess my sins to You, Lord. I realize that I have made a mistake. I have made a mess of things in my life. But God, I turn my life to You today. Will You be mine?" And guess what? He'll be yours. Amen. And I'm thankful for that today. I don't know about nobody else, but amen, I could just praise God. I could just finish the service out right now and just in a time of prayer and praise and worship unto Him and say it's been good to be in the house of God. Why? Because we've heard the truth tonight. We've got the Word of God, amen, and it speaks life to us. In Fridays, day 15, He talks about in Matthew chapter 27 and verse 51, "And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in two from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake and the rocks rent." The devotion then takes you to read Genesis chapter 1, which I'm not going to read those 38, 40 verses in Genesis chapter 1. But you should know Genesis chapter 1 is creation. Genesis chapter 1, amen, everything was created in Genesis chapter 1. And it's important to know that. And then as you read this, He says, "Behold," in the King James Version of the Bible translated, the word "behold" appears nearly 1,300 times. The word "behold," nearly 1,300 times. But when was the last time that you heard "behold" used in a casual conversation? You don't hear that no more, right? It's just not a word that you hear. However, this is what we got to understand. The word is a weighty one. It invites us to pay attention to this. This is important. We are familiar with the angel's message to the shepherds in Luke chapter 2 and verse 10. "Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy." In John's message in John 1 and 29, as he saw Jesus coming, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who does what? Who takes away the sins of the world." This is good. Today's verse calls out with the same sense of urgency. Stop, be still, gaze upon what is before us. That's why it took us to Genesis chapter 1. To gaze on the beauty of His what? Of His creation. This morning, and as I look to each and every one of us in here, are you God's creation? I am His creation, created in the image of God. I am His and He is mine. Amen? We see this. Does everybody look like us? Does everybody act like us? Amen? No, they don't. Amen? As the old saying is, it takes all kinds of people for the world to go around. I don't know how much I believe that statement, but that's what they say. I think we could, anyway. So, So we see that we are God's creation. Sister Tiffany went by somebody this morning, and she came to church, and she said, "Hey, I need to know if a couple of you guys can run over and check on this guy. He's walking on the road, and he might need some help." Absolutely. I'm thankful that she didn't stop. She shouldn't have stopped, amen. A lady by herself, amen, not knowing what can happen in this particular situation. And so I'm very thankful that she came on to church, and she told us, and me and Brother Charlie jumped in the car, and we went in the direction to see if we could find this said young man. Yes, we found him. And yes, he was rough. But you know what spoke to me? And as I read this devotion tonight, you know what still speaks out to me? He's beautiful in the eyes of God. That is his creation. He confessed to us, didn't even hardly ask two words about the man. He gave us his name. He asked what my name was. He told me his last name, got his last name. He says, "Can you give me a ride? I live right over here." This lives right over here off Hudgens Mill Road. So what seems to be the problem? He says, "Man," he said, "I've been walking for 2 years." He said, "Life's been hard." He said, "I'm going to confess to you." He said, "I was a drug addict." He says, "Every bit about it." And he says, "But I give that junk up." He said, that brought me nothing but trouble." Now, whether or not he was lying, I don't know, but this is the words he spoke to us. And he said, "I'm just trying to do what I can." He says, "I really appreciate it." "Why are you walking?" "Because the car's tore up in Sweetwater, and I got tired of waiting on it, and this is the story." And anyway, she says, "I got tired, and I just wanted to walk home." He says, "So I started walking." And as we're talking, I'm just beginning to think about this, and it's just like that there is somebody that says, "You know what, I realize the error of my way." And he says, "And because of the mistakes that I've made, I'm now living in this situation. But that is God's child." Amen? And we are called as men and women of God to do what? To reach out and to love and to cherish in the same way that Christ loves us. That's what we've been called to do, church. That's what we've been called to do. And this is what he's talking about right here in this particular text. He says, "Look at my creation. Understand it. Look around to everybody that you see and know that they are my creation. Does everybody love me? Does everybody come to me? Does everybody turn their ways to me?" No. He said, "But that doesn't matter." He said, "They're still my creation." That's what we can't miss. Amen. Christ died to save who? To save everybody. Amen. And it's not for us to pick and choose, amen, who can be saved and who doesn't need to be saved. "Stop, be still, gaze upon what is before us. This deserves your undivided attention. Behold," invites us to pause, look, and see the work of God. Yesterday, Saturday, is nothing but the blood, day 16. If you're doing this pickup tomorrow on day 17, the man behind the curtain. Today, we're going to finish out with this, and we're going to close with this. Nothing but the blood in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7. In whom we have what? Redemption. Through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. Does it have anything to do with me? It has nothing to do with us. It has everything to do with Him and His blood. Remember that one drop of blood. Colossians chapter 1, 15 through 23. Who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? Who are we talking about? None other but Jesus Christ. For by Him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created by Him and for Him. Verse 17. And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist. Let's look at verse 18. And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell. So it makes God happy that in Christ all the fullness of the Godhead dwells in Him. Let that sink in. And having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, By him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. He says, you once were enemies and alienated in your mind because of the wicked works you've done. He says, but now you've been redeemed by Jesus Christ in the body of his flesh through death to present you, how? Holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Verse 23, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. It says, as she stood in the back of the church, that Leah recalled the time she would hear these words spoken from the pulpit. The blood of Christ was shed for you. Could it still be true? His blood shed for me? Yes, in Jesus we have redemption. What was lost has been restored through his blood. What was lost is what? Restored through his blood. Amen. I once was lost, but now I'm found. How? Because of the blood of Jesus Christ. There is no other way. The Bible tells us over and over again, he says, there is not but one way unto the Father, and that is through Jesus Christ. He says, many people have come and they try to go different ways. He says, but they're all thieves and robbers. He said, there's no other way to get to God except through me. Amen. I'm thankful for that word tonight. I'm thankful to know, amen, that we are the redeemed, that we are sanctified, that we are set apart and made meet for the Master's use, that we are, praise God, the righteousness of God. We are the righteousness of God, amen? Because of what we've done? No, because of who we are in Him, because of what He did for us. Amen? I'm holy tonight because I read my word and pay my tithes and come to church. No, I'm holy because of Jesus Christ, because he says you were holy. Amen. Because why? Because he's holy. Amen. Praise God. Stand with me tonight. Thank you, Jesus. He's faithful. I started with he's faithful, and I'm going to finish with. And I'm going to end. I'm going to finish with him being faithful. Always, always want to give a time and an opportunity for prayer. You might be here tonight and you say, you know what? I get it, but I don't get it. That's okay. As I talked about this morning, you might not understand all things. You might have a lot of questions. You might be going through some things in your life. Amen. That's okay. Guess what? This altar is the best place to find that redemptive work of Christ. It is the best place to pray and to seek God's face and to draw nigh to Him. Amen. And to seek His face for whatever situation that you might be going through. Amen. If you desire prayer, if you want prayer tonight, if you say, you know what, I don't know Jesus as my Savior, I want to know Him as my Savior, then this is the place that it needs to happen. You can do that right here. You can come to this altar. I'll meet you in this altar. I will pray with you. I will take you through the steps of salvation. Amen. And praise God. And God will do a great and mighty work in your life tonight. If you're here and you say, you know what, hey, I've just got some struggles, troubles, trials, tribulations like we talked about this morning, and I just need prayer. All you got to do is come. We'll gather around you. We'll pray over you the prayer of faith. Amen. And believe the word of God for you. With every head bowed, every eye closed. I want to tarry for just a moment. Thank Him. Just take a moment to worship the Creator. Take a minute, a moment to worship. And thank Him for saving your soul. Thank Him for dying upon a rugged cross. Thank Him for taking the wrath of God upon Him. That it's not poured out upon you, but yet in turn you received His righteousness because He took the wrath. You received His love because He took the wrath. And just worship Him for just a moment. And if you're here today and you say, you know what? You say, you know, I just can't come. I just can't come to the altar and pray, but I want you to pray for me. if you would simply slip up your hand, nobody's looking around, I would be happy, happy to add you to my prayer list and pray for you. Anyone at all that says, I just need prayer, preacher, would you pray for me? Yes, thank you for that. Yes, thank you for that. Anyone else? Thank you, Jesus. God is good. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. Church, I want you to pray with me this evening. We had about 3 people that raised their hand. Going through some things, some struggles, troubles, hard times, tribulations. Who knows what they have a need of, but God knows what they have a need of. We're going to join with them in prayer because I'm asking those individuals to pray. And we're going to join with you in prayer right here tonight. And we're going to believe God to do whatever that you need God to do in your life. You need a miracle? We're going to pray for a miracle. You need healing in your body? We're going to pray for healing. You need finances? We're going to pray for finances. You need deliverance? We're going to pray for deliverance. You need a touch from God? We're going to pray for a touch of God. But let's just do that together, because the Word says that, He says, if I can find just 2 people that'll come together and touch and agree upon any one thing on this earth, He said that it shall be done in my Father which is in heaven. I believe that Word tonight. Let's join together and pray for these individuals. Father, in Jesus' name, you saw the hands that were raised. Now, Father, I come together in the power and the spirit of unity and agreement. And Father, that whatever they have a need of, Father, if it is a physical need, God, I ask you to meet that physical need. I ask you to provide for them a way that they've never been provided for before. God, if it's a mental, spiritual, emotional, God, whatever that it is, I'm asking you to open up the windows of heaven and pour out that promise upon them. That, Father, that they will have a drawing of the Spirit of God to find themselves in the Word, seeking your face and drawing nigh to you, surrendering everything that they have unto you, O God, I pray. And that as they do that, you're going to begin to speak to them through the Word, and you're going to begin to answer their prayers, Father, I pray. Lord, in the name of Jesus, if one of those 3, Father God, need deliverance, God, we know today that you are the deliverer. If they need salvation, God, save them. If they need hope tonight, God, give them that hope, that peace that passes all understanding. God, let them know that they are loved, that they are highly favored because of Jesus Christ, that they are the redeemed of God. And Lord, and we stand as your redemptive work tonight, Father. And we ask you to make a way where there is no way in their lives, in their homes, in their families. God, save their children. God, save their grandchildren, if they got grandchildren, anybody that is connected to them in their family unit that is lost, God, we're praying for Holy Ghost conviction to grip their hearts and souls, and that they would be saved before it is everlasting and eternally too late. Father, bless this church. Help this church to do the work of the gospel of Jesus Christ. God, that we will be missionaries in our own communities, missionaries in our own town, Father, missionaries in our own families, Father, that we will spread and teach and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, let this church be a city set upon a hill that cannot be hid. This is not our church, but this is your church, Father. Now, I pray that you would use it to win the lost. Use it to bring hope. Use it to bring peace. Use it to bring the redemptive work of Jesus Christ alive. Let the Spirit of God flow and move freely in this house through your people, Father, I pray. God, I ask you to move us out of the way, that we as individuals will let go and let God. God, I ask you to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us when we fail you. Forgive us the many times that we do come short, because we know that we do. God, we need you. We need you to show up. I want you to manifest your presence in this house like you've never done before. In all the years of existence, of all the souls that have been saved, of the countless people that have been in this building and the other church across the street when it was there, from the day that this church began to have its first meeting until now, let the power of God be revealed and be manifested like no time ever before. Let more souls be saved in these last days than there ever has been before. Let more people be healed in these last days than there ever has been in the existence of this church before. Lord, we call them out and we call them in. Family members that used to come that no longer come. God, we call them back into the house of God. Lord, we ask you to mend what's been broken, to put back together what has been torn, because we know that you are the author and the finisher of our faith. Now do it, O God, I pray. In Jesus' holy, sweet, and precious name that we do humbly ask and pray. And the church says, amen and amen. To God be the glory tonight. I pray that you'll leave this place.